I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com, and this is a closer look at Star Trek's Lower Decks Season 1, Episode 2, entitled Envoys. We're going to get right to the plot because I don't feel the need to do the main character introductions like I did with the first episode. Boimler is stoked because he got the best assignment on the ship, which is to pilot Klingon General Corrin to Tel'Gana 4 to attend peace talks. This episode is going to be heavy on Klingon references.
Or maybe it's just because all Klingon names sound the same, like they all have an apostrophe for some reason.
Yes, that's it!
Okay, writers, how about Antak, Azetbor, Barak, Chang, Gorkon, Gowron, Grilka, Horega, Kalis, Kang, Claw, Kol, Kolos, Koloth, Kor, Corral, Korax, Kortar, Kruj, Korak, Kern, Laneth, Lursa, Mara, Martok, Tenevik, Srelo, Vok, or Worf? Those are pretty much all the named Klingons, or most of the named Klingons in canon, and none of those have an apostrophe. Just saying.
Nuknech!
Yeah, keep it subtle. Nuknech.
Nuknech is a real Klingon greeting. Good job. Tendi is excited about watching the Trevoli Pulsar and wants Rutherford to join her. The thing is, he has maintenance duty in the Jeffries tubes, so he quits his job in engineering and transfers to another division in order to make time for Tendi. Seems a bit extreme to me. To mess with Boimler, Mariner gets herself assigned to General Corrin's shuttle as well. It turns out that she knows Corrin from some off-the-books gray ops stuff from back in the day.
Do you two know each other?
Yeah, we did some off-the-books gray ops stuff back in the day.
We're like the same age. Back in what day?
Boimler correctly points out that they are about the same age, so what back-in-the-day stuff is she talking about?
Okay,
you go down. There we go.
I don't know what Klingon drinking song that is. It's probably new, but it's not the one we hear from Worf on Deep Space Nine that ends with Josh Kales Moror Mi Hoch Choku. That one? Yeah. Corrin tells Boimler to land at Little Kronos in the Klingon district because he wants some gach. But Corrin gets drunk on the way there and is passed out by the time the shuttle lands. While Boimler and Mariner are trying to figure out what to do, Corrin wakes up and takes off with the shuttle. Now they have to go find him.
This is serious! I think we're violating the Khitomer Accords!
The Khitomer Accords are mentioned. That's originally from the Undiscovered Country. The Khitomer Accords created a peace treaty between the Federation and Klingon Empire, originally in 2293, then were later revoked by Gowron when the Federation opposed the Klingon invasion of Cardassia Prime, and then only to be reinstated later.
You know we're going the same speed.
Stop it. It's to conserve energy. Section 31 does this.
Boimler says Section 31. That's almost a throwaway, and it's really hard to hear. But we first heard about Section 31 in Deep Space Nine and much more extensively in Enterprise and Discovery. Mariner and Boimler check the Klingon district, but Corrin isn't there. Hey, that lady has a Mekleth, just like Worf. There are a bunch of canon species around here. This one is Kalon. I think the only other time we have seen Kalons is their first appearance from the TNG episode Half a Life with the great David Ogden Stiers as Lawaxana Troi's love interest, Timison. Rutherford tries the command division and goes to the holodeck with Ransom for some training.
Nothing compares to the firm, hot pulse of a joystick in your hand.
That's funny, and it's also a reference to Riker from Insurrection when he manually piloted the Enterprise-E with a PC joystick that appeared out of a console and was never mentioned before or since.
Computer, access manual steering column. Transfer helm controls to manual.
FYI, in situations like that, try employing the Janeway protocol.
Obviously a reference to Captain Catherine Janeway.
Collision alert, sir! The kindergarten on deck 8! It's gone! All the pre-K is gone! All the ship's children have been ejected into space!
The kids into space gag, that's gotta be in there because the Enterprise D famously had lots of families on board all the time, which could be very problematic considering that it's always in dangerous situations. So that's probably why they put that in there for a little bit of acknowledgement. Rutherford keeps getting his crew killed in each simulation, so that doesn't go so well. Even though the last thing Mariner mentioned was the Andorian district to the north.
All right, come on. There's an Andorian district just north of here.
They end up in an area that looks like Risa instead. Yep, that's a great big Horgon, which of course one displays when they are seeking Jamaharon. Both references come from the TNG episode Captain's Holiday, which is also the first time we get to see Vash and Max Grodenchik as a Ferengi. He plays Sovok in Captain's Holiday, Par Lenore in The Perfect Mate, and then of course Rom on many episodes of Deep Space Nine. Corrin isn't here in Risa Land, and Boimler gets attacked by an Anabaj, which is hilarious, and also one of the species made up just for this show. He is getting pretty depressed about his lack of practical alien knowledge, of which Mariner seems to have in abundance. Since command didn't work out, Rutherford is now trying his hand at medical with Tendi. Turns out he has a terrible bedside manner, and Dr. Ta'ana throws him out of sickbay. So now it's off to see Shax to try out a job in security. Rutherford is put in the...
Computer, initiate combat simulation.
Smorgasbord.
Smorgasbord. That's awesome. Combat simulation, thanks to his cybernetic implant, can take out a whole group of Borg by himself. Mariner and Boimler finally get to the Andorian district, but Corinne isn't there either. Boimler's alien ignorance causes him to let a Vendorian thief get away.
That Vendorian is a thief, and you let him get away!
This is the first mention of Vendorians since the animated series. This causes a huge bar fight. Mariner has to calm things down, which makes Boimler feel even worse. Even though Rutherford is excellent at security, his heart just isn't in it, and he resigns his position so he can return to engineering. A Ferengi approaches Boimler and Mariner and offers them a ride. Mariner accepts as they are short on time, and she supposedly does not recognize that this is a Ferengi. Boimler thinks this is a bad idea, and when the Ferengi turns violent, Boimler chases him off, proud that he was able to recognize the danger when Mariner did not. At this point, they find their shuttle with Corinne once again passed out inside, and get him to the peace accords just in time. Rutherford explains to Tendi that he had to return to his job in engineering and apologizes for not being able to watch the pulsar with her. She says it's no big deal and that she can watch it on her pad in the Jeffries tube with him. She probably should have offered to do this to begin with. I just want to take an aside here, as Jeffries tubes are mentioned several times in this episode. If you're not aware, the maintenance corridors are named after Walter Matthew Jeffries, who designed the original Enterprise, the D7 Klingon battlecruiser, and a whole bunch of other stuff for the original series. And the reason I care is because he's from Lebanon, Pennsylvania, which is where my maternal grandparents are from. Given their age, it's possible they could have met at some point. Okay, back to the show. Boimler makes fun of Mariner in front of the Lower Decks crew about not recognizing the dangerous Ferengi. What he doesn't know is that the Ferengi was a friend of Mariner's named Quimp, who is voiced by Tom Kenny, most famously known as SpongeBob SquarePants, and the whole thing was staged to bring his confidence up. Aw. If I had a pick on this episode, it would have to be the somewhat convoluted B story with Tendi and Rutherford. Switching jobs to watch a pulsar seems like a bit much, but we get the smorgasbord and joystick jokes, so that's cool. I really like the myriad of Klingon references. It's almost like they brought Ronald D. Moore on board for this. They didn't, but most of the cultural Klingon stuff in canon is from his work in the 90s. It's also fairly obvious that they tried to cram as many species and familiar locations into one episode as they could. I pointed out several of these species in the video, but trust me, there's a lot more. It's just that they were literally like blink and you'll miss it type cameos. That was Star Trek Lower Decks Season 1 Episode 2 Envoy. I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com. Live long and prosper.